Machiavelli Sessions with Lowell Carnell. Pleasure to have you here. Such an honor, man.
Thank you for having me.
How was it on stage?
I felt really supported.
Yeah.
And powerful. It just, you know, I'm very used, like rap music is very, I guess, solo, you know, and feels quite solemn. And to be surrounded by such a community was really uplifting. Yeah.
I only could see you from afar, but it felt like you were pretty emotional.
It's funny, when I was talking to Gordon, who, you know, was composing the music, when we worked really closely together on getting it right. And he, at one point, he got quite frustrated with me and because I was really trying to push it towards how my music usually sounds. And he was like, you know, you're using an orchestra for what reason? You know, and if you don't use them properly and allow each piece of instrumentation to sing on its own, there's no point and we shouldn't do this. And I really understood exactly what he was saying and apologized and whatever. But, you know, when I was here, it was a reminder of like what music is for, you know, is to uplift and to support and, you know, like allow people and yourself to feel better. And that's how I felt on stage, you know, like I was supported and lifted. Yeah.
Everybody felt that.
Cool.
And it's so special that you're in the music industry for quite some time and still music does that to you and touches you. I think that's pretty special.
Yeah, I think, but not all the time. So, you know, this was one of those times where I was, you know, it's something I don't get a chance to see much and to be around, you know, the world I grew up in, the people I'm around. You know, we're not afforded the luxury sometimes of orchestra. So to be able to use it and manipulate it and collaborate with it was really powerful for me. So yeah, it's a dream come true.
Nice. Do you have any connection to classical music?
I used to play the trumpet.
Oh, really?
When I was at school, yeah. So I'm grade one. So, not, you know, but distinction. You know, I was always more focused in on jazz, which I guess, you know, kind of came out or is around that world a little bit. Like some of my friends who are jazz musicians grew up playing and learning classical music, you know, so there is a relationship between them. But yeah, classical music for me was something that maybe I saw in little pockets, you know, like if I went to see a play or saw some ballet or whatever, but not enough.
You've performed two songs. Georgetown is one of them, and it's inspired by a poem.
Yeah.
Tell us about the,
it's a poem.
The poem.
A poem called Half Caste or Guyana, depending on who is reading it and where you read it. But it's by a guy called John Agard, who's a Guyanese poet. And he's mixed race, like me. He lives in the UK, but, you know, I think he spent some time in Guyana and his family are dual heritage. So his mum is Portuguese, I think, and his father is Guyanese or was. And yeah, it was just really beautiful to see someone who looks like me reflect, you know, my story, but be older than me. You know, he's an elder, he's like 70. And to see that kind of cross-generational fact that people like me have always existed and will always exist, you know, was really moving. And it inspired me so much that I felt like I wanted to maybe offer that to people who were younger than me. And not only look like me, you know, just are an other, you know, any other. Whether it's, you know, the pressures of gender or sexual preference or religion or whatever it is, to feel like you're an outcast. I think everyone knows how that feels, you know?
You remember the first time you read the poem?
Yeah, it was only like 2 years ago. I saw it visually. I saw it on YouTube. And he was performing it at the South Bank Centre in London. And because I got to see him as well, I think it meant more because I was seeing this guy speaking these words that resonated with me so heavily. So yeah, it blew me away. I just kept watching, listening, thinking how I could manipulate it, you know?
So that was an initial thought to make something out of it, to
for sure. It was just such a big inspiration that I had to use it.
Okay.
You know, I was like, this is what I've been waiting to find, you know?
And you immediately reached out to him or?
No, we used it. I chopped up the poem, which is kind of blasphemous, I guess, and used a bit that I felt like was fitting for the song I had written. I was asked to go to a poetry show that he was performing at, and I was asked to perform some poetry as well. And, you know, usually I don't do that because it's very scary doing poetry without beats and DJ and band and whatever. But because he was there, I was like, fuck it, I have to go because I'll get to meet him and I can ask him if he'll be on my track. So I met him and he rolls cigarettes with no filter and smokes them all the way like through his fingers, right? So like he's just like burning his hands. And I remember being outside and trying to eat, like, he'd already had quite a few beers, and I was like, yo, John. And he was like, yo, what's up? And started telling me loads of stories. And I don't even think the first time we met, I got a chance to ask if I could use his poem. I was just too busy becoming his, like, his friend. but yeah, after that I asked and he said, yeah. But he gave me loads of notes on the song. He was like, yo, you got to change this, change the piano.
Oh, really?
And I was like, it's too late, John. But for the next one, yeah. I'll change it.
Nice. And then you went to Guyana together.
Yeah, video. So we went to Guyana. I went with my father, father too. And it was my father's first time.
The first time for your for my biological father.
Yeah.
Okay.
But for me, I'd been once before.
He's never been there.
No. Okay. So you know, my grandmother had moved over to the UK.
Yeah.
And my dad had always wanted to go back, but had a weird relationship with it. You know, as many, you know, I guess first generation, you know, like Black British people have this thing of like, oh, I'm Caribbean, but I haven't been there. I don't know there. I just know the culture here of beer and pool and. football and stuff. So like, it was fucked up for him to go back. I think it was a relief for him, like an exhale. Yeah.
And for you?
Yeah, the same. It was cool as well because I always wanted my dad to teach me about my culture, but the only culture my dad knows is British culture. So it was cool for me to teach him Guyanese culture, you know, to show him.
You were switching roles.
Yeah. There's a lot. I mean, you know, I'm a father now, and there's a lot. Of switching roles as you become a parent, you know, I think you take on weird positions for your mother and your father.
For example,
that, you know, like teaching my father culture, but you know, like picking my mother up. Sometimes, like, I don't really drink no more, but my mum definitely does. So then, if it's one late night, she'll call me and be like, "Oh, will you pick me up? I'm drunk," and, you know. So being the designated driver,
yeah,
that's
cute.
You know, I love that.
Yeah. And then she's acting like she's not drunk?
A little bit, yeah. She's like, shh. I'm okay.
What is your connection to poetry in general? Because it's not only John Agard, it's also, I saw that interview that you did with Benjamin Zephaniah.
Yeah. I just have a love for words. You know, it's one of the few things that, like, you know, I feel like I have some control over and understanding of, and I see the power in them, you know? And they always, you know, words have always been the thing that can move me to tears, you know? And I don't know, I just think poetry is, all rap music for me is poetry, you know, political speeches, Malcolm X, whoever, like, those speeches, they're poetry to me, you know? I don't think there's any difference. It's just how people separate them, you know? But yeah, poetry to me is just like one of the few things where I grew up and the people I was around that I was afforded to express and be able to like lift myself up, you know.
You remember the first time when this worked, to lift yourself up by words?
Yeah, it's like every time I write something, I'm like, the first time would have been just a poem I had written about, you know, what it is to be me and the feelings I was feeling and just being able to say them out loud, you know? Like your fears and your worries and your grief, to be able to like say, exactly say what's going on between your eyelids, you know? It was really cathartic. Mm. Yeah.
Now, are you sometimes scared of speaking out the things that are in your mind?
Yeah, I think you're always scared to speak your mind. But you know, whenever I look at any of my heroes, and you know, I have more heroes every day, that the ones in the moment, maybe, like, for example, you know, like when Muhammad Ali said he wouldn't go to the war, and he said, why am I going to go out there and fight the Viet Cong or whatever? He's like, these people are immigrants like me. These people are treated like me, you know, saying to America, like, you're my opposer, you're my enemy, or whatever. And at the time, people hated him, you know, and I think it's, in retrospect, for me, I'm lucky to have something like that to reference, because in retrospect, I know, okay, in the moment, not everybody will love this, you know, people will go, oh, I don't understand, or whatever. But the hope is that in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, people go, oh, okay, cool, like, we've caught up and we understand why you said what you said, or, you know, we feel brave enough to say that we feel the same. And yeah, I think it's always the most important things to say are the things that are scary to say. Because if it's easy, everyone would say it, you know. But yeah, for sure, I feel scared every day. That's the point. But it's like, if you feel scared and you do nothing, that's the issue. You know, you just have to tell yourself you're not scared.
Yeah. Isn't it a mad feeling that you find answers in the art of someone else and then it inspires you to create art and then somebody else find answers in your art? You know what I mean? It sounds so, like, it must be a crazy feeling.
Yeah, I think that's the beauty of it, though, because without that, you know, art could come to an end. You know what I mean? And the reason it doesn't is because someone will always take something from your thing and apply it to themselves and change it, you know? And in the same way, you know, even with my own stuff, you know, I find answers and then I find problems. And then, you know, when I finish a piece of work, I'm like, okay, I love it, or I hate it. And then I have to make something new to make it better or different, or to now answer the new questions answer the new questions that this previous piece of work has posed, you know, because that one has already satisfied the answers from a previous set of questions. It is never ending, which I think is the enjoyment of it, you know.
You've told us that the song is inspired by the poem, and there's another song that you've performed. Nobody Knows. Is it inspired by the choir at the beginning?
The sample is a guy, Pastor Teal Barrett and his choir. And it's, you know, it's famous. Kanye West has sampled them. But there's a line in the original song where he says, you know, I tried the black man, he didn't understand. I reached the white man, he wouldn't take my hand. And this is, he was speaking from a perspective of a black man, you know? So not even, it wasn't even as complex as my story. But this is exactly the thing, is that I heard the lyrics and was so moved by them because it spoke to me even further, because I'm neither, you know, I'm in the middle. So he's saying, oh, I'm speaking to my own people, and they're going, I don't know. But for me, I felt like I had no people. And so, yes, that is a great example of hearing someone else's answer and going, okay, but this actually poses more questions. So let me take it further. I felt very lucky that they cleared the sample and allowed us to release it, you know, shout out to them. That's the beauty of art, you know, that's the whole point. I think that when you're greedy, once you put art into the world, it's not yours anymore. And people can do with it what they want. Sometimes they'll just make TikToks with it, but other times they will make, you know, music, paintings, patchwork, quilt, something.
Where's Lattice Road?
Lattice Road is in West Norwood, in South London, in SE27. And it's where I grew up. It was the first house that I lived in. And it's where, you know, where I saw a lot of things I didn't want to see, you know? And times I didn't get to see my dad for a long time and he never would show up and stuff. So it just reminds me of, like, not like a dark time, but like a formative time, you know, in my childhood where I was exposed to life and had to grow up a bit. So, yeah. Yeah, so it's a beautiful place. It's a tiny little house that me and my mum lived in for a while, just me and my mum.
How is Lattice Road, how is it connected to the song?
So, yeah, I mean, the whole album is about forgiving my father, I guess. But this song, yeah, is part of that story. And there's a line in it, which is just about how sometimes, you know, I would come out of my house in the morning when my dad was supposed to pick me up and sit on the wall with my book and my bag and my toys and wait. And then, like, the day, like, I would watch the sun, like, be there, and then the sun would, like, leave the sky, and still I'd be there, you know. And my mum would bring me food outside and we'd chat, and then she'd go back inside, and then at some point she'd be like, I don't think my dad's gonna come. And yeah, just it reminded me, so I saw that picture so vividly in my mind of being sat, like, just on the wall and being outside that house. So yeah.
And the feeling of love means nothing.
Yeah, of, like, because my mum would say, oh, exactly, yeah, because my mum would be like, you know, let me tell him that you love him, and, you know, your dad loves you. And I was like, yeah, that's cool, but I don't need to hear it, and I need to see it, you know? Because words are words, which is kind of goes against what I was saying before, because words are powerful, but more powerful than words is action, you know?
You found that forgiveness.
Yeah, Have to, man. I mean, I'm a father now, so I have a son, and look at myself differently and look at my father differently and understand. Because it's not easy. You make a lot of mistakes when you're a parent. I know that I have already and will continue to do so. So if I'm making mistakes and I want my son to forgive me, how can my dad make mistakes and me not forgive him, you know? It's kind of bullshit, so.
But is there a way to, like, break this
cycle?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you think about it, in, like, just for me personally and a lot of my homies. Like, you know, a lot of my friends, they grew up without their dad. And a lot of my friends' dads grew up without their dad, right? And this, that goes on all the way back. And so there's always this fear that you're taking this, like, generational hate from above and shooting it downwards, right? But now with my son, I have, like, this love that's coming up towards me, right? So I'm in this position where, you know, my dad and my dad's dad and whatever, there's all this hate going down, 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 neglect and anxiety and fear and sadness. But then from the other side, there's, like, this naive hope and joy and love. And it's like, instead of taking this bit and passing it to my son, it's taking what my son has given me and passing it back up. You get me?
That's beautiful.
So that's how you break the cycle. You just turn around, you know? Yeah.
And this is also connected to, like, the end of the second verse where you quote Malcolm X on the speech about the tree.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, because his tree, in his speech, he's talking about the African-American view of Africa and how, you know, through media and, you know, political speech and everybody's view of Africa is like, oh, they're poor, they have no joy, there's no freedom, you know, they're trapped, they're slaves. When really, when you go out to Africa, it's affluent, it's abundant, the soil is rich, fruit grows, you know, like the trees are green. And he's kind of saying, if you hate Africa, that's fine, but that means you hate yourself because you are African, you know? So you can't hate your origin and not wind up hating a piece of yourself. And it's the same with your father, you know? If you hate your father, you come from this person. So they can be a bad person for sure, but you are connected to them. So if you can't find compassion for them, there are parts of yourself that you won't be able to find compassion for, you know? Because even, you know, even people whose fathers have done the most atrocious things, there's still pieces of that human being that are, you know, fundamentally good. When you look at anybody and realize why they have done, you know? Not what they have done, but why they have done it. That's when you begin to see the person, you know?
The album has a different tone than the albums before, definitely. I wouldn't expect a Loic Carner album to start with a song that's called Hate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
How was the process from the last album to Hugo?
I guess a lot had changed in the world and for me personally. And I felt like it was, you know, I felt safe and like I had developed enough of, you know, I had established myself enough to show maybe even another side of me, you know, or to be even more open. Because I think I've always been open in my music, but I've always wanted to put the nice part forwards, you know, so people would look at me and go, hey, this person is nice. Like, yeah, like this is someone I feel safe with. I'd like to indulge in this work and listen, you know, to get people to listen. But I think at this point, it's like, you know, some people are listening and now is my chance to push further and to show that there's beauty in the ugly, you know. For my son, especially, I think I kind of didn't want him to listen to my stuff and go, oh, well, I know this part of my dad, the nice bit, but I also know this other part of my dad, you know, that where he gets angry or he's frustrated or sometimes he's depressed or whatever these things are. But they're not being shown in his music. And then my son might go, well, then I won't show that to the world, you know? So I think it was important for me to go, all of you is okay for people to see, you know? Because that's the truth.
How's your view on what is happening lately in the UK music scene, rap scene, big artists like Stormzy at the Brits, Dave at the Brits, using their voice to really make a political impact? You now coming with this album, you think there's like a shift going on?
Yeah, I think, you know, they're inspirations for me because those guys are actually superstars, you know, and there's a lot of pressure to be squeaky clean in your little suit and just jump around on the stage and be like, yo, party, party. So yeah, to me, they're heroes of mine in that regard because it's not easy to do. But I think it's essential when you look back on a career of any sort of artistry, you want to look back and feel like you challenged, you know? My friend Kofi Stone had said to me the other day that art is made to comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable. And I think, yeah, you can't say it better than that. I think it's necessary. I never wanted to be like political either, you know, it's not really my like, because I feel like it can come across preachy, but it, at the moment it's just these two worlds are really colliding, because politics is life. It's not, you know, I think when you're at school, and especially when you go to school and you look like me or whatever, what your view of politics is so removed from you that you don't realize that, you know, the like the price of chocolate bars going up and all these things, or how difficult it is to get toilet roll. These things are political, you know, why I can't get a passport or go to this country as easy as this person. These are all political issues, but they're also like me problems, you know? So I think over the last few years, I think there's been a nice understanding that the people in their fancy suits and their nice cars and their big houses, they're making decisions that directly impact us. So, it's stupid not to at least be aware and speak.
No, it's not preaching. It's not preaching.
Appreciate it.
Same thing with like, I haven't mentioned her about Sims, mm-hmm. Lil Q part two, mm-hmm. speaking about her cousin being stabbed and stuff. Mm-hmm. That's like, yeah, that's real life politics at this point.
Yeah, 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 for sure. But it's also, it's beautiful. Yeah. Painful, but beautiful, because it's real life. That's why I love drill music, you know, and I think it's crazy that people are trying to ban it, because to me it's like, you know, instead of going, hey, these kids are talking about killing each other, fuck, we need to stop them from making music anymore. It's like, why don't we stop them from feeling like they have no other option than to take each other's lives because nobody's offering them a way out of this situation, you know? And that is such an obvious thing of like where the problems are stemming from. It's like, oh, we have a problem. Don't look at the source. Just look at, you know, the really small level. It's like when kids are selling drugs in the street. It's like, what about all of the people behind this one kid that's in prison? When there's people who will walk past the police, you know, barefaced, whistling, like, untouchable, you know?
Yeah. No, instead they are cutting, like, social workers and closing, yes.
Yeah, youth centres, schools, yeah. Art funding, you know? Not to preach, but that's the shit. Like, you know, that's where the issues are.
Yeah. Tell us about the end of the album.
The whole album is just about me and my dad and learning to drive. My dad taught me to drive over lockdown, right? And so he was in our bubble. It was safe. you know, we was in a car, so we're not looking at each other, but we're able to communicate. And, you know, there's no confrontation when you're driving because you don't have to look at each other, right? So we were having these big conversations and it starts very angry, you know, like, oh, you let me down and whatever, like, hate and nobody knows. And all these songs at the beginning of the album that are really like, you know, directly taken from these conversations. And then as the album goes on and as the lessons go on, you know, like my dad finally gets a chance to speak and yeah, say how he feels and the shit that was going on for him at the time. And it becomes like, you know, I'm able to go, oh, no way. I didn't know that happened. Mum never told me this, or, you know, I never saw that. I was too young. And by the end of it, I get to a point where I see him as a 360, you know, which is what I'm trying to show the world that I am. So yeah, if I want people to see me as more than just like, nice guy, then I need to see my dad for more than just a bad guy, you know?
Has he listened to the album?
Yeah. Not like, not a lot, but he's definitely listened to it just in little bits. He came to the studio a lot when I was making it and he would listen to bits when they were made. So yeah, he heard the final song, he's heard, yeah, everything.
Were you scared?
Yeah, but that's good, I think, you know, like, it'd be really rubbish if I made it and I wasn't scared, because it would just be about nothing, you know? And sometimes I'm jealous. I got friends that make, not friends, but I know people that make stuff and I'm like, oh, it's coming out soon. They're like, yeah, cool, you know? It's gonna hit the clubs or it's gonna hit the streets and people will like it. And I think that's cool and it's definitely needed. But for me, I don't think it would make me feel fulfilled. I wish it would make me feel fulfilled, because I hate this version, you know, where everything I make is scary and important and, but it's the only way I know how.
Last question we always ask every artist is, which artist do you want to see at Machiavelli Sessions?
Who do I want to see at Machiavelli Sessions? Lil Sims. Lil Sims for sure. Lil Sims.